and welcoming Secretary Clinton to the stage to share with us a few words. Secretary Clinton.
Well, good morning on this beautiful October day. It's a great pleasure to be back here at Georgetown, to be in Gaston Hall, to have a chance to lend my voice to the important work that is being done by the Georgetown Institute for Women, Peace, and Security, and to honor four remarkable women. So I want to start by thanking Dr. DeGioia for his leadership, and it's really significant the way that Georgetown under President DeGioia has stepped up to make a commitment to never forget and to continue to work on the overall goal of helping to achieve the full participation of women in peacekeeping and diplomacy. And it's incredibly important that Georgetown does this because the Georgetown Institute is the premier institute in the world that has, since 2011, made the case, gathered the data, put together the analyses about what a difference it makes when women are fully participating in peacekeeping and in diplomacy, when they have seats at every table discussing national security and vital interests. And of course, that is possible because of the extraordinary leadership of Milan Verveer. Ambassador Verveer has, as you probably know, established the whole idea of women, peace, and security so firmly here at Georgetown that other universities, other institutions around the world are looking here for leadership and inspiration. You know, the last time we were together, it was to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Good Friday Agreement and to honor, much too late, but still to honor the critical contribution that women played in bringing about an end to the so-called Troubles in Northern Ireland. And we gather again this year to keep up that momentum, to recognize the roles that women play in peace and security, and to keep urging that more governments and more multilateral institutions do more to include women's voices. But I think it's fair to say that as we gather together, there are some incredibly powerful forces at work around the world. Some of them, like climate change, which we are seeing unfold in real time before our eyes. Some like unimaginable technical advances, like artificial intelligence, whose pluses and minuses we have no real understanding of yet. Two changes in the geopolitical environment, the return to great power competition, some of the conflicts that are not just springing up in Ukraine, but continue to haunt the world. Now, these forces impact every one of us, but they do disproportionately impact women. It's no surprise that the drive to diminish women's rights is actually linked to the quest for political power. Many leaders use women as a reason for pulling back on rights, use women's lives and aspirations as a challenge rather than an opportunity to existing power structures. And these forces that are at work around the world have created perilous times for everything that we have held dear and that we believe in can make a better world for everybody, women and men. You know, people from all walks of life are mounting a massive resistance to autocracy, to the oppression of women and girls, to irresponsible big tech companies whose platforms are absolutely rife with misogyny and sexism and viral attacks on women in the public sphere. So we are trying to tell a different story, a different narrative for the future by not only standing up for democracy, human rights, and progress, but highlighting women who are doing it in their lives every single day, like these incredible women who you will hear from in a minute. You know, protecting and promoting a free press is critical to all of us, to our democracy, our sense of security and freedom. And it's imperative that we have women's perspectives in journalism, just as we must have in national security and diplomacy. We need to hear stories about what's actually happening in people's real lives. We need to hear what happens to women in repressive places like Afghanistan and Iran, whose rights are being either totally denied or shrunken. We need to hear the stories, sometimes hard to listen to, of women in Ukraine, where Russia is using rape as a tactic of war. We need to hear the stories here in the United States where maternal mortality is higher than in any advanced country in the world. We don't take care of mothers. We do not take care of children the way that we should. Now, I think it's important to recognize that women should not be characterized as victims. I reject that at every turn. Women are agents of change, and women's stories are powerful reminders of what is possible. More than 10 years ago, I stood on this stage and announced the Obama administration's executive order establishing a national action plan on women, peace, and security, an ambitious and necessary step. We've made progress, but we still have a long way to go, which is why the research done here at Georgetown in the Institute is important. I'm also excited to be back in the classroom for the first time in many years at Columbia University, where we just launched a women-led and women-founded Institute of Global Politics, trying to connect the local and the global, which is critical, and to continue the hard work of advancing the rights and full participation of women and girls, which is the great unfinished business of the 21st century. So I don't think I have to convince any of you in this room how vital this mission is, but I hope to convince you to use your voices, your agency, your activism to stand up for women who are under threat, who are often marginalized, pushed to the sidelines, whose stories are not being told. We have an extraordinary lineup of award winners. Now, personally, Christiane Amanpour is someone whom I've admired for a very long time before I ever had a chance to meet her or be interviewed by her. We just did an interview elsewhere here on campus. But I saw her reporting from crisis zones, often the only woman, you know, wearing a helmet and a flak jacket in the midst of conflict, but trying to tell the rest of us what she was seeing and hearing. She has received every major broadcast journalism award at least once, but she's being awarded today not only as a trailblazer for women in journalism and a fearless truth teller, but as someone who has worked really hard to make sure women's voices on the ground, wherever she's reporting from, are included. You know, Alaa Sulla gained national and international attention when there was a photo of her standing on a car leading protest chants in Sudan that went viral in 2019. I have to say, Alaa, I saw, you know, Alaa Sulla's photograph, I saw the video. I was so incredibly moved by what you were doing. I was also worried and afraid for you, but I was so happy that you were there and you were standing up for the rights of all of your fellow citizens, particularly women and girls. She emerged as an important voice for the transformation of her country. After the spark of revolution came the long, patient work of rebuilding, often the hardest work. You know, why do revolutions fail? Well, oftentimes because it's really hard to turn a country around, to build institutions of government, to govern. And she was in the midst of doing exactly that. She dedicated herself to working with a broad coalition of women and activists. And even today, despite the conflict currently underway in Sudan, she is working to figure out what can be done when the fighting finally stops. Now, Muna Lachman is a co-founder of the Women's Solidarity Network, a chairperson of the Yemeni Foundation Food for Humanity, and a member of the Women's Alliance for Security Leadership. Working with Yemeni grassroots organizations, she is always advocating for women to have a seat at the peacekeeping table. And I have to say, Muna, it reminds me, Milan and I were at a conference together 2 years ago, right after the start of the war in Ukraine. And we were working to get humanitarian supplies, particularly food. And we were working with the wonderful organization World Central Kitchen, headed by Jose Andreas. And they were setting up kitchens and handing out food all over the country. But we were in conversation with women on the ground in Ukraine, and they were telling us they need to move where they're giving the food out. They need to have a different setting. They need to move it over here. And we immediately got on the phone and started telling people, we're hearing it from the women who are collecting the food and feeding people, and here's what you need to do. So I know, Muna, you're on the ground, you're doing that work, and you are not only a voice for Yemeni women and peace, but you are a worldwide advocate for peace. You've been frequently involved in briefing the UN Security Council, members of Congress here in the United States, and the UN Human Rights Council. You know, Ghalia Al-Rahal is going to be with us virtually. She is the founder and executive director of Mazaya. That is an organization for empowering women, and she's a member of the Syrian Women's Political Movement. I have to say, let's not ever forget Syria. They have been under brutal attack from Assad and Assad's allies, Iran and Russia, for a decade. And she is someone who, in defiance of personal threats and attacks, including the assassination of her son, a journalist, has been working to energize a Syrian women's movement. In 2013, amid the war, she converted her beauty salon into a center to provide education and first aid to women. Mazaya is now a network of 8 women's centers and 5 childcare centers, and publishes a magazine that makes the case for education and empowerment for women and girls. So before I end by congratulating once again all of our awardees, let me ask all of us, myself included, what is it we need to do to protect democracy here at home? What is it we need to do to make sure women's voices are heard, that they aren't drowned out by the constant attacks on social media that are quite frightening to many women? What is it we are to do with our educations from a great great university like Georgetown to lift up more women here at home and around the world? There's a role for all of us. So as we celebrate these awardees and thank them for their courage, determination, and faith in the power of women working together to build a better world, let's recommit ourselves to do everything we can right here in the United States to make sure we never lose our freedoms and our democracy, our rights and opportunities. Thank you all very much.